New on Curiosity Stream. She was a loving wife, a devoted mother. She also stole atomic secrets and gave them to the Soviets. Meet the woman whose deception kickstarted the Cold War on The Spy Who Stole the Atom Bomb. And...
what if they catch you?
Then I shall be shot.
They're coming! Come back!
Relive history's most death-defying escapes. It's Impossible Escapes, Civil War. Watch now on Curiosity Stream. Annual plans are $20, just $1.67 a month. Visit curiositystream.com.
Oh, drat, I was driving along minding my own business when that vulgar leech hit my Beamer with his pickup truck. I fear I've fractured my clavicle.
I say, old boy, don't simply put it in the hands of your insurance company to sort it out. Talk with the dedicated rogue solicitors at the Advocates Law Firm.
Pipe down, you old sod. The Advocates will see your case through to the bitter end and won't sleep a fortnight until they have victory in their grasp.
Jolly good, old man. Jolly good indeed.
You get injured, the Advocates get results. AdvocatesLaw.com.
What's up? It's your boy, the Fed Smith. Thanks for listening to the Men's Room Daily Podcast. Want more? Check out the greatest podcast in all the land, The Podcast. Be sure to subscribe and listen to a brand new episode every Tuesday night.
Somebody out there deserves to be recognized. And the Men's Room knows just who it is. So to you, we say, bottoms up, sailor. You're the toast of our shot of the day.
Great time it is, and as usual, we head to the drink desk and Steve Throw Hill to find out who we're toasting.
Yes, indeed. And today we toast 32-year-old Leobardo Hernandez of Panoma, California. This man is a fool, but I admire his effort. Now, on Saturday morning, the cops there, they tracked him down in a stolen car. He ends up taking off running, all right? And eventually, he busts into an apartment complex, and he runs into a stranger's apartment. So he gets lucky in this case because the apartment was unlocked and no one's inside. Right? So he hazards a guess he gets in there. But then he tried to pretend like he lived there and that he'd been there all along, knowing the cops eventually would track him down. So what did he do? He shaved. He changed his clothes. So now he's wearing his person's clothes. He even started cooking. So when the cops get there, his ploy is, hey, man, I don't know what you're talking about. This is where I live. Well, the cops, they did track him down. And as a result of them tracking him down, he ended up burning the tortillas he was cooking. So now the fire department also had to come to the scene. He eventually surrendered and was arrested on several charges. I like the play, though. This is where I live, man. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So let's have a drink. We pour this booze and we drink this booze because we think it's yummy.
Yummy.
So over the tongue and down the throat to party in our tummies. Down the hola, bitchola.
The Men's Room presents Profile This.
And Stephen Throw Hill, can you please tell everyone how Profile This is played?
I sure can, Miles. It's a simple game where we share with you a real-life news story, something that happened right here on planet Earth. And as you listen to the story, based on the stereotypes you believe to be true of people and the decisions that people make, we'll ask you what it is you think makes the story a story. Hello, Matt. Welcome to the Men's Room.
Hola.
Hola. All right, Matt Daddy, you understand how this here game is played?
I sure do.
All right, then you know you have one of three choices. We have the wonderful world of drugs. We have bite me. In other words, what did someone find in their food? And finally, interior decorating, where you guessed the foreign object that ended up on the inside of someone.
I'm going to go with drugs.
Go with drugs. All right, here is your story. We go to the fine state of Connecticut, where a man who police said was dripping blood and high attacked a 77-year-old woman who was walking with her two great-grandchildren. Now, the man got to the woman in a headlock until a police investigator working a case nearby came to her aid. Captain Richard Conklin said police were called on a report of an elderly woman being attacked by a younger man. Well, the investigator, he was working a case at a gas station when someone came running in yelling for help. Well, the suspect here, he began pulling the man off the woman who had dropped to the ground. And as the woman's 22-month-old and 9-year-old great-grandchildren looked on, he began fighting to subdue the man. Well, two bystanders rushed up to help restrain the man before other police units arrived. Now, the woman, who suffered minor injuries in the incident, told police, but the man approached her acting in a, quote, bizarre manner. He had blood coming from a number of injuries. Anyway, apparently, as he approached the woman, he beckoned for her and the older child to go with him. The woman said she pulled the children behind her, at which point this guy grabbed her and began choking her in a headlock. Now, he, of course, has apologized, but also he was really, really high. The question is, what was he high on? Was it crack, PCP, heroin, or cocaine?
Oh, man. I want it. This really, really sounds like PCP to me. A lot. Ted, what do you think?
Run it through me again.
Crack, PCP, heroin, or cocaine?
No.
It just out of nowhere, and he's already bleeding from previous injuries, approaches this woman. She puts the kids behind her, starts to walk away. He puts her in a headlock, starts choking her out.
Right, so he's already bloody.
He's already bloody.
Is he naked or clothed?
I believe he has clothes on, since I didn't point out nakedness, which I feel like always makes its way in if you're naked.
And where was it?
In Stamford, Connecticut.
Man.
Matt, I got a theory on this. After watching the Aaron Hernandez documentary on Netflix, for some reason, Connecticut's got some weird drugs to make people paranoid. I'm going to go PCP.
Right, that's what he was smoking. Well, Connecticut, too, you got to keep in mind, like, a large group of people that come from Connecticut are very, very wealthy. And the rest of the people are the opposite.
Right.
Right, there's some tough towns in Connecticut. Not Greenwich.
Or Bristol.
Right? PCP, crack. Yeah, feels PCP. PCP, crack, meth.
And heroin.
No, crack, PCP, heroin, or coke.
Oh, sorry.
Ooh, could be a fancy white person all coked out of their brain, though.
You know them fancy white folk with all the cocaine on the nostrils.
That's what I don't go into gated communities.
It's like everyone's snorting donuts. Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know, Miles, you're probably right that it's PCP, but I just want to choose something different. You know what? I'm going to go crack.
Ted's in crack.
Crack.
I'm going PCP. Matt, what are you thinking?
Rock it up.
I'm going with PCP.
Final answer. Okay. Right. We're going to find out what this guy was on. Crack, PCP, heroin, or cocaine next.
That was a tease.
New on Curiosity Stream.
Just because it hasn't been done before doesn't mean you can't.
Watch Earth's greatest minds forge our path to a better tomorrow. It's engineering the future and... Jaws, Star Wars, The Godfather, E.T. The biggest movies have even bigger music. From King Kong to The Dark Knight. See how musicians scored Hollywood's greatest hits on great film composers' music of the movies. Watch now on CuriosityStream. Annual plans are $20, just $1.67 a month. Visit CuriosityStream.com.
Well, great balls of fire, Bubba.
What happened, Buford? That crazy son of a Sal blew right through that four-way stop of Main Street and plowed into my cowboy Cadillac.
Your what?
My pickup truck. And I'm pretty sure my leg is broken, Ted.
Oh, quit your bitching, Buford, and talk with those side busters at the Advocates Law Firm. When I got busted up last month, well, shoot, they made sure those snakes at the insurance company played fair.
Boy, howdy. Even that creepy so-and-so Kyle earned his keep.
So if you get injured, the Advocates get results. AdvocatesLaw.com.
This podcast is brought to you by the Washington State Department of Health. As we continue to listen, learn, and grow, we are amplifying Black voices and perspectives in an effort to start a new COVID-19 vaccine conversation. We're sharing stories intended to help us navigate this unprecedented time together and to co-create solutions in support of the Black community. Hear these stories at WeConsiderWA.org.
Back to the conversation. This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. 99.9 KISW.
Category is drugs on profile. This Connecticut man was dripping blood and he was high on something. He attacked an elderly woman for no reason. She was with her grandchildren. Mm-hmm. She suffered injuries in the attack and he tried to choke her. He didn't apologize, didn't know what the hell he was doing. He was on drugs. Question is, what drug was he on when he did this? Crack, PCP, heroin, or cocaine?
And that is a question we posed. Ted Smith, you went with crack.
Went with crack.
Oh, I'm sorry, it wasn't crack. And Matt agreed with you, Miles, that it had to be PCP. I mean, hell, he's violent, he's aggressive, and he's pre-bloodied.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You are correct. Yeah. PCP is kind of the obvious one, man.
Yeah. Doesn't remember anything. All right, now fall TV news all time. It's time for TV Time with Tim.
And now, because your pathetic life is confined to countless hours in front of a talking box.
I'm again.
The Men's Room presents TV Time with Ted.
All right, he's back in action this week. So one of your options will be Trevor Noah.
Trevor Noah.
By the way, respect to Trevor Noah. I liked it after Christmas. He took 2 weeks off. Granted, his show is very political, but like, oh, we got an election. I'll take 2 weeks off.
I've had enough.
It was just crazy. I was like, wow. The Jimmys.
Jimmy Kimmel, Jimmy Fallon.
Of course, our buddy Seth Meyers.
Seth on the list.
and Ted Smith.
Is it Ted or is it late night?
All these guys have teams of professional writers who come up with their monologues each and every night. It is up to you to determine, is this an actual late night joke and from whom, or could it be a The Ted Smith original?
It's being reported that Kanye West is not happy that his alleged divorce from Kim Kardashian will be broadcast on TV. It's almost as if he doesn't realize who he married.
Seth Meyers.
Does sound like Seth, but I'm going to go Ted.
Yeah, that's me.
Oh.
I know. That'll shock you, right? Now they're saying it's going to be part of the final season ever of Keeping Up with the Kardashians.
Good Lord. Like, must-watch TV, yeah.
So that's a tease, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, look, if you watch that show, I'm sure you'll watch it, but I don't understand how you could marry Kim Kardashian and be, like, don't put this on TV. Like, her whole life is like...
Of course she does.
Right.
Two rich people. One lives in Wyoming. One lives in Los Angeles. Tell me what you think of that.
Right. In his inauguration address, President Biden promised he would be, quote, a president for all Americans. Though it was weird when he added, even for New England Patriots fans.
Jimmy Kimmel.
Seth.
In his inaugural address, President Biden promised he would be, quote, a president for all Americans. Though it was weird that he added, even New England Patriots fans.
What a time to be a president. There's a raging pandemic. The economy is crumbling. And for 2 years, the country has been caught in a vicious chicken sandwich war.
Trevor Noah.
Yeah, Trevor Noah.
Jimmy Fallon.
What a time to be president. There's a raging pandemic. The economy is cratering. And for 2 years, the country has been caught in the middle of a vicious chicken sandwich war.
By the way, that's not a war. It's Popeyes.
Wait, do we know
Popeyes
yet?
Because they just keep coming out with more, so I don't know if there's... But I
think it started with Chick-fil-A versus Popeyes, right?
Right,
And Chick-fil-A, I love Chick-fil-A. Their chicken sandwich is great. But if I had to pick one, I think I'm going Popeyes.
Yeah. Mm, okay.
Yeah. Now, if I want nuggets, I go to Chick-fil-A. It's a toss-up.
Your chicken game is strong.
Yeah.
You're talking nuggets or sandwich,
right? That's right. That's what I'm saying. Mike, earmuffs. Gorillas in a Chicago zoo were fed popcorn in celebration of National Popcorn Day, which makes me very nervous about their plans for Father's Day.
Seth Meyers.
Yeah, Seth Meyers.
Yeah, that's Seth.
Gorillas at a Chicago zoo were fed popcorn in celebration of National Popcorn Day, which makes me really nervous about their plans for Father's Day.
Mike wouldn't mind if it was their gorilla fathers.
Mm-hmm.
You still hating the gorillas?
Every day, man.
Every day,
full of heart. Yeah.
I wake up with just a scowl on my face knowing that they're still around.
I know. Some people talk about Tom Brady and how long he's played or LeBron James, and like they still have the fire. Most people don't know is the fire that burns deep inside of Mike Hawk for gorillas.
Gorilla hate. Giraffe hate coming up in headlines.
Gorilla hate also sounds like a song.
It really does.
Yeah. I guess I'm thinking gorilla warfare, as we just heard rage. Mm-hmm.
Real big.
Gorilla radio.
Oh, sorry. There you go. Real big in Uganda.
So, months ago, John Mulaney... Everybody knows John Mulaney. He was a writer for SNL, very funny comedian.
Okay. Oh, yeah,
He's hosted a few times. Actually, you know what? I should know this, but is he out of rehab? I saw he just went back into rehab.
Oh, damn. I don't know.
Mulaney was one of those guys that always talked about the booze and the coke.
Sure.
And then he always talked about in his act how he was sober and this and that. But I think right before Christmas it came out that he was like, yeah, the pandemic's been tough. I got to go back into rehab.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, which... I mean,
I understand.
Obviously, if a guy's been to rehab and wants to be sober, you know. But I'm just like, yeah. I mean, 2020 wore on a lot of people. Like, I'm not surprised.
Get me my powder and my booze.
And if, yeah, bless you. And there was a lot of people who came out and admitted it.
Yeah,
I mean, it's one thing to slip; it's another thing to come out and make a public statement and say, "Hey, I slipped."
Yeah, I always bring this up, but the Nick Kroll show, him and Mulaney are good friends. There were some very good skits on there too.
Okay.
So Mulaney, when he was on Saturday Night Live last February. He made a joke about Donald Trump. Basically, he was talking about Julius Caesar was a powerful maniac that all the senators grabbed knives and stabbed him to death. He said, that would be interesting if we brought that back now. So then John was on Jimmy Kimmel Live last month, and he said,
that joke had the secret led to a Secret Service investigation.
Oh, damn.
Yeah. So now the Secret Service, they came out yesterday and confirmed it was releasing a 27-page file on the incident. It said, quote, although no direct threats were made due to the popularity, it is likely concerned citizens will report this.
27 pages, huh?
So here's the deal. I think people reported it.
Sure.
So the Secret Service, I mean, if you've ever seen, let's say, In the Line of Fire.
With Clint Eastwood?
Clint Eastwood, okay. Yeah. They break down, and that movie's a couple decades old, but they break down, like, there's a ton of threats against the president all the time.
Every day, right.
Right. So the Secret Service, though, to their credit, like, they vet almost all of them out.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Like,
Cabin to Kathy Griffin.
Right. And honestly, like, people, like don't make those kind of jokes. Whether you're on your social media, any kind of media, I don't care who.
Trust me.
Yeah, it's not worth it.
It's the equivalent of saying bomb as you're going through TSA.
Right.
I mean, you just have to know.
They're going
to
come find you. So the good news for Mulaney is that they had the report, but they didn't knock on his door. Like, he was never personally interviewed.
Okay.
On Kimmel, he said he was, quote, the person vetting me was very understanding. They were very nice in the interview. So I think that he just got a phone call or whatever.
Sure.
And look, the Secret Service, I'm sure, gets it. Like, John Mulaney.
But you still have to investigate, right?
Yeah, it's just crazy that actually happened. You're like, holy cow.
Yeah, we had Secret Service in a restaurant I worked at once because we were serving, oh, God, what was it? Boris Yeltsin's wife, Tipper Gore, because Al Gore was vice president at the time, and like the mayor of the city or whatever. So they closed the restaurant down, and it's just them. So they had a kind of a prefix menu, right? They're not like ordering off. So, but they had a Secret Service dude like in the kit, and they're just staring at us to make sure we don't poison the food or anything like that.
Yeah.
They never caught me.
We know.
No, but Tipper Gore actually told me that she said, I enjoyed the meal. And I wanted to tell her, you know what? I kind of hate your guts because all that crap putting labels on records back in the day. Like, you made my life a living hell. But I didn't. I simply said, thank you, ma'am.
Appreciate it.
But the secret, so here's the thing about them, though. So we knew in advance that these people were coming in, like 2 weeks in advance. You know, this is the restaurant. Like, all right. So the way the Secret Service worked, they said, look, we're not cops, and we don't feel like being cops. So if there's anyone there who has, like, a record, tell them not to work that
warrant.
Day. And the people that are choosing to work that day, we need their social security number, right? No problem. Well, one of the dudes, one of our dishwashers, he was out on parole, but, like, he missed one of his parole meetings or whatever the hell. He worked that. The Secret Service showed up and had to arrest him.
Yeah.
I mean, it was crazy. Yeah. And it was like, I don't know, he had been busted for, like, stealing Snickers bars 15 years ago, whatever the case is, but he'd missed meeting him. So anyway, they ran his number. He was there. And they're like, man, if you just weren't here, we would not come looking for you. But since you were physically present, we have to take you in. I'm like, God damn.
Yeah, but I worked at the AFL, we had him in our building all the time. Because we were literally, we were just across I Street from the White House. But if you went on the sixth floor, like, if you didn't call the Secret Service at the White House, like, if you stepped out on that balcony, the phone would start ringing.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because if the president's in the White House, there's all kinds of stuff on top of it.
When you reach that level of detail and intel and all that stuff, I mean, we're no strangers to getting in trouble.
Sure, not in trouble.
Not here, right? Yeah. But I'm telling you, the one time that I was really, really freaked out about being on the air wasn't when we thought the building was burning down.
Right.
For any of this stuff, we got a very urgent message from Sergeant Hair Club that what happened at 312, blah, 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 blah.
We don't know.
We have no idea. Like, what did we say? And he wouldn't say because he was really frantically running around trying to get audio, thinking, well, Ben, I need this audio now. You can cut this crap up. You know, so he's running around trying to get this stuff. We didn't know what the hell was going on. We couldn't put it together. Someone had called in, and they had made an admission about something at the border.
They were running drugs over the Canadian border. All right. So, but the problem was, and it was something they were actively doing. And he's telling us this on air, suit yourself. But then he added, because we're like, how do you not get caught? How do you not nervous? And he points out that one of the border guards is his buddy, right? So now you're stepping on their turf, man. I mean, these guys were here. Probably
they were in the hallway.
They were in our, right, they're in the studio.
We're still in the dark on what exactly was said. We
don't know this yet, right? Yeah, so it's just some real serious looking dudes sitting in the producer's box with Ben, and we just see him cutting up on it. And we still don't know what's happening, but it's like, man, are we arrested for something?
What the hell happened? And that was all we knew, and that was it. And then they left.
Yeah, and then it was so Ben explained. He said, man, remember that guy who called? I'm like, yeah. I was like, dude, he only called like 30 minutes ago. He's like, yeah, their asses are here. We had to cut the audio. And Ben said, he said to them, he's like, hey, man, I might be able to go back like in the phone logs and get the guy's number. He said their response was, we can get his number. It's like, Jesus Christ. Yeah, and they were out. That was it.
We were like, yeah. Shh, wasn't us, thank God.
So again, if you're running drugs over international borders.
Don't call our show and announce
it. I mean, you can, but that's what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That scared the hell out of me. I'm like, why are these guys here?
Of course
man?
I do.
Freak me out, man.
I never know how to say this. Wilmer Valderrama.
Just say Fez, bro.
Fez,
right?
Yeah. He was on the Kelly Clarkson show and talked about buying the station wagon from that 70s show. Did you guys ever watch that 70s show?
Sure.
Yeah. Is that the green one with the wood panel? Is that the one?
I don't remember what it looked like.
I think
green one with a wood panel makes me think of Christmas or Vacation. The original Vacation. Yeah. The
wrong station wagon.
But anyhow, he said he bought it. Said we were in the last season. I straight up went to the props department and said, "Listen, how much for the Vista Cruiser?" They said $500. So I bought it.
Damn.
Yeah.
What a deal.
Yeah.
On any car that runs.
He said it's the best thing he's acquired in his whole career. When I look at that car, it reminds me when I was 17, 18 years old. Booking that 70s show and doing that opening sequence where we were just driving. Which is pretty cool.
That's cool.
Yeah, don't think for a minute when I'm bringing somebody home. Like, I love that 70s show. Come on in my garage. Take a look at this. Next thing you know.
Yeah.
Right back to being a teenager.
Especially that dude.
Yeah.
Apparently
he crushes it.
Yeah. Well, that's like Joey from Friends. Matt LeBlanc.
Mm-hmm.
When he had his other show, Episodes, there was a part of that, a lot of that was just people would have sex with him because he was Joey from Friends. But one of the episodes is like the girl's like, let's just say she's looking down at him.
Uh-huh.
And she's like, say it, say it. And he's like, how you doing?
Exactly.
Right.
That's all I got to do? Okay.
Go. Cool.
Yeah.
Ola Bachola?
Okay.
Stay beautiful.
Yeah. What do you want me to say?
Right.
That's after.
Yeah.
The shotguns are a different effect.
Okay, I'll be Captain Crunch. Get.
We've been talking a lot about reboot. Man.
You struggle with that one.
Reboots.
Yeah.
It should be easy.
Yes.
What did I say this morning? I screwed up something. Oh, the Bee Gees.
What did you call them?
Oh, yeah.
I'm not going to say it here.
Oh, that's right. Yes. Off by one letter.
So these are the, basically, Rolling Stone put together a list, the best TV reboots of all time.
All right.
Which, that used to be kind of an easy thing to do, but nowadays there's so
there's
many
a million
shows.
Of them.
Right.
Are they all within the last 2 or 3 years? Are there any that we don't know about or can't really remember that are back? Like in the 80s, or are they all just newer?
So, the oldest one started in 2003.
Okay.
But it's already off the air. Some of the, I'm just going to help you out. Some of these you won't get.
All right.
Reboot meaning a totally or mostly different cast, but the same principle.
Like Hawaii 5-0 style?
Is that what, yeah.
Some of these don't have completely different casts.
Okay.
All right.
They just were gone for a while, and then they came back. So number one on the list is DuckTales. DuckTales was a cartoon.
That was top of my mind.
You guys were thinking DuckTales.
Sure, that one. How do we miss it?
The Conners make the list, right?
All right.
Right, because that was Roseanne back in the day. That came back in 2018.
And she took some of that racist drug. What the hell was it? Ambien. Yeah.
Ambien, yeah. Made her racist.
Like that woman who called.
Yeah. Well, same thing does tequila to
Mel Gibson. Except for she didn't lose weight.
Over on Netflix, The Babysitter's Club. That just came back in 2020.
Not familiar.
Babysitter's Club is a show about babysitters.
Oh, I thought it's what you beat them with.
Right,
the Babysitter Club. Why don't you do these dishes when we are gone?
Let me give you a hint on one. There's something out there.
X-Files.
Yeah. Right, and I think when that came back on Fox, they'd say, like, that still had pretty much the same cast.
Yeah, I mean, I think everyone. If you weren't dead, you were basically on the show.
I did not realize that they had rebooted this show in 2016 on History. I will give you a hint. I think all three of us watched it, and it was a mini-series event.
On the History Channel.
Right. I did not realize they rebooted this.
I don't know, man.
All right, Chicken George.
Oh, Roots.
Yeah.
One thought it was a restaurant.
Chicken George.
Chicken George.
I'll try it.
All right.
Trust a guy named George to make chicken.
They rebooted that?
Thank you.
Huh.
I didn't write until I saw this list. I was like, You redid Roots?
I mean, it's such a positive, uplifting, wonderful, funny, warm family movie. Why not?
We left so much out.
Right.
Yeah, I'm with you. That one kind of...
We want to make it more violent, you know?
Well, I get maybe saying, hey, we should, you know, not that I would, but I'm saying I get the theory of like, well, what if we rebooted it so a newer audience could see it?
Sure,
but most of it takes place in the 1800s. Like, technology's not going to make that look any less 1800s
exactly.
Or 1700s.
And there were no particular special effects, you know? I mean, I don't understand the point of that.
Yeah. I mean, I do think everybody should see it, but happy is not the word I would use to describe.
No.
Like, oh, hey, guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to go home and knock out a couple episodes of Roots. Like, is that nobody?
Smoking weed. Right. Yeah. When Stephen Miller show up?
Columbo? That got rebooted on... So I didn't realize that it started years ago, and then it came back on from 89 to 03 on ABC.
He basically just came in at the very end and just made some ridiculous statement, like, as far as his hypotheses, right, on everything.
He was the guy... You know, he would kind of set you up and then always end with something like, oh, one more thing, or whatever the one more question. This is how I nail you guilty.
So you're both right. During the usually they were hour-long. My mom loved this show, so I remember. So he'd always say one more thing or one more question.
All right.
Right? And then you're right. At the end of it, he would just put it all together and it'd be like, how does he do it?
He's a genius.
Guy's mad skills.
You think he's Italian?
Columbo? Ends in a vowel.
Came back in 2005, and it's still on Sci-Fi and the BBC. Mike, you might know this one. You dabble in nerd stuff.
I mean... Doctor Who is kind of a
there
reboot
you go.
All the time, though, right?
Doctor Who.
Isn't that constantly rebooted, though?
It's always
like a big deal if there's a new doctor. So, I mean, is that a reboot or is that just what they do?
It went down for quite a while, and then it was rebooted like early 2000s or something like that.
Was it Benedict Cumberbatch? Was he Doctor Who for
a while? No, he never was. No, it was a lady, if I'm not mistaken, been the last Doctor.
Was he not Doctor Who in the movie?
Sherlock Holmes.
Sherlock Holmes.
What's the difference?
He was in an English show, all right?
Same nerd crap.
One Day at a Time, that came back to Netflix and Pop TV in 2017. That used to be a famous soap opera.
I remember that. Valerie Bertinelli.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
That was a sitcom. Half-hour sitcom.
It was, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. I'm confusing
you have one life to live.
Yeah, I am.
Wow, you piece that together well, bro.
Twin Peaks, The Return, that came back to Showtime in 2017.
That was on the Adult Channel.
It's not a bad place to get a burger and a brew.
I'm Rusty Johnson.
And then the number one thing, and most people like, if you like star stuff, Battlestar Galactica.
Right. Yeah.
I never watched the new one. I remember the old woman as a kid, and it was terrible.
What was that guy's name? Dirk Benedict. Wasn't he in the A-Team, too, or was that my favorite?
Yes, he was.
He was Face.
Yes, right? He was Face in the answer. Well done, Ted.
Yes. Yeah. Nice.
Thanks, Ted. We appreciate it. You are listening to The Men's Room.
New on Curiosity Stream. She was a loving wife, a devoted mother. She also stole atomic secrets and gave them to the Soviets. Meet the woman whose deception kickstarted the Cold War on The Spy Who Stole the Atom Bomb. And...
what if they catch you?
Then I shall be shot.
They're coming! Come back!
Relive history's most death-defying escapes. It's Impossible Escapes, Civil War. Watch now on Curiosity Stream. Annual plans are $20, just $1.67 a month. Visit curiositystream.com.
Bro, gnarly. What's up, Taylor? Dude, that nerd in his electric hybrid totally blew the light while texting his yuppie friends.
That's so bogus, bro. Are you hurt?
Yeah, like I can't move my hips, bro. I think I broke my pelvis, man.
Dude, no way!
Wait!
Taylor, you need to drop a dime and talk with the lawyers at the Advocates Law Firm.
No way, can't afford that, bro. Your crotch is broken, man, and they don't earn any money unless they win your case.
Dude, no way.
You get injured, the Advocates get results. Contact me today at advocateslaw.com.
This podcast is brought to you by the Washington State Department of Health. As we continue to listen, learn, and grow, we are amplifying Black voices and perspectives in an effort to start a new COVID-19 vaccine conversation. We're sharing stories intended to help us navigate this unprecedented time together and to co-create solutions in support of the Black community. Hear these stories at WeConsiderWA.org.
The Men's Room returns with Miles and Thrill. Now, let's see what's happening in the real world.
All right, here we go. Oklahoma politician introduces bill to make 3 months Bigfoot hunting season. Meanwhile, a woman freaks out when she sees a giant rat chewing on her sleeping boy's hands. And with good reason. McDonald's worker explains how the drive-thru works. Pro tip, don't pick your nose. Woman shocked to see man in neighbor's yards in a taking a dump type pose. And a man steals a python from a pet store.
by jamming it down his pants.
Damn.
It is time for your headlines.
Now, it's time to hit the headlines. Here's my car.
All right, top driver, go to the UK where a woman's morning coffee was interrupted. The woman is new to the area and was settling into her new home with a nice cup of morning coffee. And whilst enjoying her morning, she was interrupted by a disturbing sight in her neighbor's yard. A man, having a squat, as it were. Shocked, the woman pulled her phone and recorded the incident, which the man saw but paid no mind. She posted the video on the community message board, saying that it was clearly not his first time doing this, as he even brought his own toilet paper.
Damn. He was a jogger. It's right. Always the same. Delivery person, jogger.
Don't mind if I do.
You're going to do profile this. I mean,
sure.
Typically only two people. You're crazy. That's an option.
A spur-of-the-moment thing I can somewhat forgive somebody for. I still am not a fan of it. I don't know that I'll endorse it or condone it. The fact that he's running around with his own toilet paper, I have an issue with this guy. Right.
Well, yeah. Also,
I'm just going to do it. Well, no.
Look, in the last year, now more than ever, if someone is going to do that and has done it,
mm-hmm.
it's going to be in that window. You can go to a Starbucks and go in and use the bathroom.
That's fair.
You can go into McDonald's and go in and use the bathroom.
Right.
I mean, that might be one of the hardest things to find, is a bathroom when you need one.
Castle's house.
Right. He's got one out front.
Yeah, he's got a porta potty out front.
So make sure that you run either close to a bathroom or close to your bathroom. Not poop in my alleyway, thank you.
Or just make sure that you play a home game before you take off running.
That's
know?
Fair, too. Absolutely. In other news, still in the UK, a woman broke the number one rule of breaking the rules. She filmed it and posted it online.
Why?
The woman had authorities called on her when she caused a drunken disturbance inside the local McDonald's, standing on counters and twerking for all to see. Before barricading herself in the bathroom to hide from police, live streaming the entire event as it unfolded.
Yeah, you're going to get busted.
After that incident ended, she was arrested again the next day for a similar incident at a local pub. Showing no remorse, the woman actually took to her the comments of her own live stream to let people know that she was simply looking for a bucket and a mop for this, yeah, you get the song. She ended up with a court date instead. Get a bucket and a mop for this.
On some level, I like her.
Yeah. She, honestly, just seeing her pictures, she looks like the gal that would give zero F's about what she was doing.
Right.
She's young and free, and I'm just going to go ahead and go do it. All right, well, you're going to have a lot of court costs then. Have fun. Sad story out of Nashville. A tragic scene was live-streamed at the local zoo of a mother giraffe giving birth. Speaking of live-streamed events.
Why's that sad?
Well, hang on there, Ted. There were complications with the birthing process, and staff had to assist the animal. Luckily, they were able to save the baby from those complications and left her with her mother for the two to bond. Fortunately, moments after the drama had ended, the mother stood up and accidentally stood on the young one's neck.
Oh!
An event that they were not able to bring her back from. And this entire thing was all over the live stream as well.
Oh, God.
So everybody, you know, you guys remember April, the giraffe that was pregnant for like way too freaking long and everybody celebrated.
I remember the giraffe. Yeah, yeah.
So I don't know why this has become a thing. One, April became a thing, I think, just because I think we needed some good news, whatever year that was. And right. Two, she was just pregnant for too doggone long. So now this is just the bet that keeps on betting, and so that's why we did it. But for some reason, it turned into this thing now to where every time a giraffe is pregnant, we have to film it.
Right. Yeah.
We have to live stream it until this giraffe
gets
hurt.
You ever watch two giraffe males fighting?
Oh, yeah, it's horrible.
Oh, my God. I watched it on Planet Earth the other night. This one guy, it's like boxing.
All right.
It's either headshots or body shots, right?
Yeah.
So this one guy, giraffe, I'll call him Dave, he keeps ducking and weaving, right?
That's right.
Guy cranks it up. He floating ducks like a butterfly. Out of the way. Ducks out of the way. The other guy gets wind. Maybe the head game's not too strong for me. He goes for the knee. Goes for the body. Starts just absolutely cracking him down below because he realizes he can't get a headshot in.
All right, so he's doing the body blow.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Starts working the midsection.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Exactly. It's
so Dave's getting
terrifying to watch.
Oh, yeah.
What was the other giraffe's name?
Gary.
Gary. Okay. Yeah.
You know those little prongs that they got in the top of their heads?
Yeah.
I won't even call them antlers because they're fuzzy little prongs.
But when they both walk away, they're both like they're messed up. Like their skin's
bloody
coming
scarred.
Off.
Bloody scarred, yeah.
I mean,
those things are rough.
Heads all banged up, man.
Yeah, man.
There's a lot of live cams on a lot of zoo animals.
Okay.
You can just watch them all the time.
It always seems to be the giraffe that comes up. The pregnant giraffe always seems to be the one that everybody needs to talk about.
That's the name of my new bar. The pregnant giraffe.
The pregnant giraffe.
Yeah. But, I mean, there's some places you can just watch the otters swim around and this and that. I think the giraffes, because giraffes are very exotic, and then you're right. The one giraffe was pregnant for so long.
Right. April. Moving on. A woman now retold the terrifying story of what she found in her son's room. Late one evening, she heard cries coming from her 18-month-old son's room, and when she opened the door to find was a massive rat that was hunched down taking a bite out of her son's hand.
Jeez. Oh.
She swept the rodent away after it had left a nasty 3 bite marks in the toddler's hand and took the young man to the hospital. The rat had been a particular thorn in the family's side, having crawled over her in the middle of the night, but not being fast enough to catch it. She says the animal is also not afraid of people, saying that it was known to charge them instead of running away when confronted, and the rodent was eventually tracked down to its lair with the help of a cat that spent a few days there, and the rat was killed. So this mom, after coming in, obviously her son is screaming and in pain and has been bit. She was traumatized from it. There were nights that she's sat there awake staring at her child because this rat is too doggone brave. It's going to go back into my kid's room and start just gnawing on my son.
Sure.
I don't need this right now. So they ended up getting a cat, and then the cat did what the cat did and tracked down the rat. And now there's no more rat. And that is it for your headlines. With that, Mike Hawk is out.
Oh, man, we'll see you on Friday, the return of Ted versus the FCC in an epic mashup.
On Bad Choice Friday.
Yes, indeed, it is all true. But in the meantime, we be all up out this bitch. So until next time, please do what you do best. And for Aletha's sake, stay beautiful.
The Men's Room has been taped before a live studio audience. Wardrobe and makeup provided by Mantastic Limited. This has been a presentation of the Men's Room Radio Network.
Oh, man!
A Double Flush production.
20 million dollars, $19 million, $6 million. These are all awards recovered for clients of Phillips Law Firm. To win big, you have to fight big. And Phillips Law has been fighting the too-big-to-fail insurance industry for decades. Not every case will have a multi-million dollar outcome, but Phillips Law will fight just as hard to recover the outcome you deserve. If you or a loved one has been injured in a car accident or on the job, call or click today at 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
This podcast is brought to you by the Washington State Department of Health. As we continue to listen, learn, and grow, we are amplifying Black voices and perspectives in an effort to start a new COVID-19 vaccine conversation. We're sharing stories intended to help us navigate this unprecedented time together and to co-create solutions in support of the Black community. Hear these stories at WeConsiderWA.org.